إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فإن أخر الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. All praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who is truly worthy of all praise. To Allah belongs the most beautiful names and attributes of complete perfection. And all thanks is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who is the source of all blessings. And peace and salutations upon the Messenger of Allah, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who was sent as a mercy to all of the alameen. Dear brothers and sisters, there is a very important issue which we find that the Quran addresses and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam addressed, but we find that the Muslims, they have become very easy in this matter, to the extent that we've become so liberal that even those people who are religiously inclined have now thrown this matter aside. And there is no doubt that that was out of the plotting of Shaitan. And Shaitan makes something fair-seeming to people that they forget their mubadi, the principles which Islam has given them. And this problem is such a problem that it can create great turmoil in the society. And that is the issue of ikhtilat, free mixing and khalwa. When a man is alone with an ajnabi woman and they are outside of the view of other eyes, nobody can see them, they are alone. This issue is addressed in the Quran and it's addressed in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and it is an issue that there is no doubt that we need to remind ourselves. This subject, inshallah, I'm going to try and deal with it under seven headings. The first of which is the danger of al-khalwa. خطوط الخلوة. And then the second heading will be the different types of khalwa that can come about, which are forbidden in the Sharia. And then inshallah we will discuss some of the things which have happened when people didn't abide by those principles. And then fourthly, we're going to talk about ikhtilat and the proof to explain the tahrim or how it's forbidden, this ikhtilat, and then some of the different surah, the different types of ikhtilat that can happen, and then some of the stories that actually came to pass. We've had incidents, share some of those incidents with our brothers here, and then finally what the Quran has to say about it, and the last answer, which is wa hal min muddakir. The Quran is a reminder. So who will listen to the reminder? Brothers and sisters, if a man is alone with a woman who is ajnabi to him, she is a stranger to him, she is not one of his, he's not one of her muharim, she's not his daughter or his mother or his sister or so on and so forth, he's not one of those relations, and he's alone with her, and people cannot see them, they're not in a public place, then this is forbidden. This is called khalwa. And this is haram in Islam. You know, sometimes people think that the piety of our hearts is something we can measure. So it doesn't matter how righteous we see ourselves. And it doesn't matter how pious the sister sees her heart. Regardless of all of those things, khalwa is something which is forbidden. The Prophet ﷺ was with his companions. This hadith is narrated in Bukhari and Muslim. So there is no doubt about its authenticity. And it is narrated by Sayyidina Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu. And he says that the Prophet ﷺ said, لَا يَخْلُوَنَّ رَجْلٌ بِإِمْرَاتٍ. A man should not be alone with any woman. And then the Prophet said, وَلَا تُسَافِرَنَّ إِمْرَاتٍ إِلَّا وَمَعَهَا مَحْرَمٌ. Except, she should not travel except that with her is a mahram. Whose statement is this? It's not my statement, it's not your statement. It's not the statement of any person less than the Prophet of Allah, the Messenger of Allah, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who we are ordered to obey. When he speaks, we are quiet and we listen. And then we say we have heard and we have obeyed. That's what's required of us. One of the companions of the Prophet ﷺ, when he heard this statement, the narration mentions, فَقَامَ رَجُلٌ. A man from the companions of the Prophet ﷺ, who heard these words directly from the Prophet ﷺ, stood up. He said, يَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. He said, O Messenger of Allah, إِنَّا مَعْتِي خَرَجَتْ حَاجَّةً. My wife has gone to perform the Hajj. And and I have signed my name down to participate in this battle. She is going to perform Hajj. And I couldn't go with her because I had written my name down to go to participate in this battle, in this war. What did the Prophet ﷺ say? She is a noble woman. And she's going for a good cause. That's okay. And because you are busy now and you have something very important to do, this jihad fi sabilillah, that is okay. Some of us might be surprised to hear what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. The Prophet said, "Idhhab fa hujj ma'a imra'atik." Go and perform the Hajj with your wife, with your woman. These are people who have already traveled. So the man went from that majlis, he got on his riding beast, and he went and caught up with the caravan which was going to perform the Hajj. You know what's very strange about all of this? We would have made so many excuses. We would have made so much falsafa about this matter. We would have said, but she is a righteous woman. And she is going with some other women who will look after her. And I'm going to perform this great duty of jihad fi sabilillah. And you know, I really trust my wife because she's trustworthy. How many of us have said statements like that? And how many of us would have said statements like that? This companion, this shows the reverence that the companions had for the statements of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Did they argue? Did they make excuses? They heard and they obeyed. The Prophet ordered him, he left. You know, this is a sign for all of us, isn't it? That when we look at how we would have behaved and we look at this companion, then we have no reason to ask why the Muslims are in the state they're in. then there's no reason to ask those questions. Because we don't have that level of faith. And subhanAllah, you know, nowadays you'll find it, particularly this issue of Hajj. Every time Hajj comes round, and a lot of sisters ask the same question. I don't have a mahram, but I've been told that I can get a visa through the person who is providing this Hajj service, that he will pretend that he's my wali, and I'll get a Hajj visa and I can perform Hajj with these other sisters. What sort of Hajj is this? When the offset of the Hajj is based on haram. You're doing something on the offset which is haram. How can this be piety? The beginning is deception. So what will be the fruits of that deception? What will be the fruits? Incidentally, a woman who doesn't have a mahram is considered a woman who doesn't have the ability to perform Hajj. And until she has a mahram, she doesn't have to do the Hajj. Brothers and sisters, the situation that we don't realize is that the position of a woman in Islam is so high, her honor is so high. This is why Islam has given her this decree that she cannot travel alone. Many of the sisters think, look, these religious people, these fanatics, they're just trying to cause problems so we can't have freedom. And I want more freedom. Wallahi, Islam has given the woman a status which is unrivaled. If we look at the mother, a woman is a mother. Allah has laid the Jannah at the feet of the mother. What more honor can a man or can a woman ask for? The man all day he toils. And the brothers who are sitting in front of me will appreciate this. That when you go out to earn a living, how many problems the men face. They have to deal with sometimes people who are not very nice to them, abuse them, say things to them. They endure difficulties in their work. They don't get time to do the things they want to do because of their responsibility to their home. Did ever a man say, why is Jannah not on my feet? I do all of this. He's accepted. That if Jannah is at the feet of a woman, then this woman deserves it because she is a mother. Just like I have a mother, you have a mother. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the woman this status. When she is a mother, Jannah is at her feet. When she is a daughter, subhanAllah, we didn't see the time of Jahiliyyah, but we hear what would happen when people would take their own children, their infant daughters, and they would bury them in the sand. Because of this, my honor and my status, and how much haram and injustice happens because of this. My pride. So they would take their infant daughters and they would deliver them to the dirt and they would bury them alive, screaming and crying. Then Islam came along. Fatima, radiallahu anha, would come in the majlis of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Nabi of Allah would stand up for her. He would stand. Other people came, he would be sitting. When she would come, he would stand up for her to greet her. This is the status of a daughter. Look at the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He never had any sisters. But subhanAllah, when his milk sister came, How much honor he gave her. Islam has given the woman this status. And for this status and for her honor to be kept intact, Allah has laid down rules that she doesn't travel alone, that she should avoid khalwa. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has narrated again in Bukhari and Muslim, the Sahihain, the hadith of Amr ibn Rabi'ah. He said, لا يخلون رجل بإمراتي لا تحل له فإن ثالثهما الشيطان. Why has the Prophet forbidden this khalwa? The hadith just narrated here, the Prophet said, indeed it is forbidden for a man to be alone with a woman who is not lawful for him. She is not from his mahram. So why is it lawful? Why is it lawful? Because the Prophet said, فَإِنَّ ثَالِثُهُمَا الشَّيْطَانِ. Because the third of them is Shaitan. Shaitan is the third of them. And when the third of them is Shaitan, what will he whisper into their hearts? What will he call them to? The Prophet said in the hadith narrated by Jabir, on the authority of Imam Ahmad, he says, مَنْ كَانَ يُؤْمِنُ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ فَلَا يَخْلُوَنَّ بِإِمْرَأَةٍ لَيْسَ مَعَهَا ذُو مَحْرِمٍ فَإِنَّ ثَالِثُهُمَ الشَّيْطَانِ. The Prophet said, and listen carefully to the condition that the Prophet put, مَنْ كَانَ يُؤْمِنُ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. Whoever amongst you believes in Allah on the last day, he's a believer. The believer, what will he do? فَلَا يَخْلُوَنَّ. Then he should not be alone. بِإِمْرَأَةٍ لَيْسَ مَعَهَا ذُو مَحْرَمٍ. He should not be alone with a woman who doesn't have a mahram. فَإِنَّ ثَالِثُهُمَ الشَّيْطَانِ. For verily the third of them is shaitan. Where are those people who say they believe in Allah on the last day, and then they are alone with an ajnabi woman? They make khalwa with an ajnabi woman. Shaitan is the third of them. What do you think shaitan does? Well, have we seen in our lives examples? How many of our brothers, they made this mistake? You find that one of our brothers fell into sin, made zina, and then not just only zina, he left his wife and children and went off with some other woman. How many times we scratched our heads and said, why did he do that? His wife was a good woman and a pretty woman, prettier than the woman that he ran away with. Have you ever asked yourself that question? How many times we saw it? And we said these same words. She was fairer than the woman that he ran away with. Do you know why he did it? Because the third of them was shaitan. And he made this woman, who was ugly, seemed beautiful to him. And he made his own wife at home, who was halal for him, look ugly for him. And so this is why he substituted what was pure and fairer for this radhila, which called ifsad of his lineage. And he calls his name to be thrown in the dirt, and for the people to speak about him. Yes, brothers and sisters, khalwa. He left this pure, righteous, fair woman at home and substituted her for this ugly and of low character woman. Brothers and sisters, there are so many examples of these things, but I don't want to dwell on these examples because it's not befitting that we should mention some of these examples in the house of Allah. And that I should say it or that you should listen to it. There are so many madahir of this khalwa that the Quran mentions some examples of them. And the example that we want to mention, and this is, I believe, based on the statement of the Quran, one of the most dangerous examples of khalwa. When a man is woman, alone with a woman, the most dangerous of all of those examples is when the woman of the house is alone with her servant. This is the most dangerous. And you might think, well, this doesn't happen here. It happens here, and it happens in the lands of the Muslims, where people have servants that work in their homes. This is the most dangerous example. And I want to refer you to the Quran, the book of Allah. Have you ever tried reading it? Wallahi, if you are upset, it will give you relief and comfort, and it will fill your heart with joy and happiness. If you are transgressing and lost, it will guide you and bring you back to righteousness. It is the discourse with Allah, the book of Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us an example of this very dangerous scenario where a man who is a slave or a servant is with his mistress, the master of the house, the woman. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, A'udhu billahi min shaitan ar-rajim. وراودته التي هو في بيتها عن نفسه وغلقت الابواب وقالت هيت لك. Who is this the story of? It's the story of no less than one of the Anbiya of Allah, Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salam. Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salam experiences problems. Khalwa between his mistress and him. He had no eyes for her. But little did he realize that somebody else had eyes for him. And this is sometimes the fault of people. That when they're in a state of khalwa, we might think we don't care about the person, we have no care for them, we have no interest in them. But little do we know what is in their hearts. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us, and she in whose house he was sought to seduce him to do an evil act. And she closed the doors and said, come on. Subhanallah. Khalwa. Look at Yusuf alayhi salam. He is an innocent man, but he is only a slave, and he has no status in that society. We know him in the Quran to be the Anbiya of Allah, and as far as that is concerned, he has the high status. But to her and to those people at that time, he had no status. He was only a servant, bought and sold at will. But look at this woman. She was a woman who had status from the noblest family. She had wealth. Her husband was a minister. So she was a woman of status. She was a woman who was fair. She was beautiful. And she had wealth. All of the things that, or some of the things at least, that men look for in a woman. And she sought to seduce the Prophet of Allah, Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salam. And look at him. Now he is in his youth, in his strength. She sought to seduce him. And Yusuf alayhi salam, what does he say? قَالَ مَعَاذَ اللَّهِ إِنَّهُ رَبِّي أَحْسَنَ مَخْوَايَ إِنَّهُ لَا يُفْحُ الظَّالِمُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protected Yusuf. What was Yusuf's response to her? قَالَ مَعَاذَ اللَّهِ I seek refuge with Allah. I seek refuge with Allah from what? From this radhila that this woman is calling me to. إِنَّهُ رَبِّي. Who is he seeking refuge with? Allah. إِنَّهُ رَبِّي. He is my Lord, my nurturer. إِنَّهُ أَحْسَنَ مَثْوَايَ. He is the best with whom to seek shelter and protection with. إِنَّهُ لَا يُفْلِحُ الظَّالِمُونَ. Indeed, Allah will not cause those who are ظالمون to be successful. The Nabi of Allah, Ma'soom, is protected. Allah is protecting him. He has a talbiyah, which is not like the talbiyah of the rest of mankind. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him inayah khasa. He is being protected. So when this scenario presents itself to him, Allah showed him his signs. And Yusuf alayhi salam saw the signs of Allah and he sought refuge with Allah. But what about me and you? But what about me and you? And this is where the Sharia has put down these rules of interaction. That we don't allow ourselves to fall into this despicable act. It's a despicable act. You know, some people, they will allow it for themselves to do this act with others, with somebody else's sister, with somebody else's daughter. But imagine if it came to your house and your sister or your daughter was on the receiving end. At that, our skin gets goose pimples. And we would not tolerate that. And for that, we would kill. You see it in the newspapers, honor killings. We have so much sense of honor for ourselves. But what about honor for other people? This khalwa. This khalwa which we are so easy about. We are so easy about this matter. We are so liberal about this matter. But little do we realize how much is going to be lost. How much will be lost? Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salam, he is saying, Ma'azallah, inna Rabbi. Seeking refuge with Allah, his Lord, from this action. Why? Because the third one is Shaitan. He's seeking protection with Allah from what? From Shaitan and the whisperings of Shaitan. Because Shaitan is the third of them. And what does Shaitan say? قَالَ بِعِزَّتِكَ لَأَغْوِيَنَّهُمْ أَجْمَعِينَ. By your honor. Shaitan is swearing, making halif. SubhanAllah, even in the statements of Shaitan we learn something. He didn't make halif. He didn't swear by other than Allah. He swore by Allah. We Muslims haven't learned that yet. When Nabi. Some people swear by the Prophet. Some people swear by their food. Well, now. The Prophet said, if you were going to swear, then swear only by Allah. Shaitan told us that as well. But we Muslims, we still haven't learned that. Incidentally, Imam Shafi used to say, مَا حَلَفْتُ بِاللَّهِ صَادِقٍ وَلَا كَالِبٍ. I never swore by Allah, whether I was telling the truth or lying. Why? Because look at the status of Allah in his heart. That nothing in the dunya is worth swearing and taking the name of Allah. Nowadays we hear the Muslims, every statement, whether it is an important matter or something which is just in jest, wallahi billahi tallahi, all the time. Shaitan says, قَالَ فَبِعِزَّتِكَ لَأَغْوِيَنَّهُمْ أَجْمَعِينَ. He said, by your honor, O my Lord, by your honor, لَأَغْوِيَنَّهُمْ أَجْمَعِينَ, I will cause them all to go astray. Why is it Shaitan didn't go astray? Why is it that Shaitan couldn't cause Yusuf alayhi salam to go astray? Why is it that Yusuf alayhi salam didn't go astray? Shaitan said, إِلَّا عِبَادَكَ مِنْهُمُ الْمُخْلَصِينَ. Look at this statement. He said, except those of your slaves who are mukhlasin, they are sincere to you, O Allah. I will cause them all to go astray, except those who are sincere to you. What did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say about Yusuf alayhi salam? كَذَٰلِكَ لِنُسَرِّفَ عَنْهُ السُّوءَ وَالْفَحْشَىٰ إِنَّهُ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْمُخْلَصِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about Yusuf alayhi salam. And in this way, we turn away from him as su, evil. وَالْفَحْشَىٰ lewdness. إِنَّهُ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْمُخْلَصِينَ. He is making tazkiyah of Yusuf alayhi salam, saying, indeed, he is from our slaves who are mukhlasin. They are sincere. Shaitan wants to say, and is saying that I will cause them all of them to go astray except those who are mukhlasin. And Allah says, making tazkiyah of Yusuf, he is from our slaves who are mukhlasin. That's why Yusuf is protected. Because he is from the mukhlasin. But as for the rest of us, we don't have the ismah that Yusuf has. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala order us to protect ourselves. Continuing with the story of Yusuf alayhi salam, when the women, they started to talk, Yusuf refused to fall into this sin. And so the women of the city began to talk, the rumor began to spread that the wife of the minister, she is seducing her slave. And they began to belittle her and to mock her. And she became the talk of the town. Then she decided that they should see Yusuf before they say statements about her. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَقَالَ نِسْوَةٌ فِي الْمَدِينَةِ امْرَأَةٌ عَزِيزٌ تُرَاوِدُ فَتَاهَا عَن نَفْسِهِ قَدْ شَغَفَهَا حُبَّهَا حُبًّا إِنَّا لَنَرَاهَا فِي ضَلَالٍ مُبِينٍ. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in verse 30 and 31, and women in the city said, the wife of Al-Aziz is seeking to seduce her slave, this young man Yusuf. Indeed, she loves him violently. Verily, we see her in plain error. When she heard this, فَلَمَّا سَمِعْتْ بِمَكْرِهِنَّ أَرْسَلَتْ إِلَيْهِنَّ وَعَتَدْ لَهُنَّ مُتَّكَنْ وَآتَتْ كُلُّ وَاحِدَةْ مِنْهُنَّ سِكِّينَ وَقَالَتْ اِخْرُجْ عَلَيْهِمْ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that. So when she heard of their accusation, she went for them and prepared a banquet for them. She gave each of them a knife to cut the food with. And she said to Yusuf, come out before them. And of course, when he came out before them and they saw him, فَلَمَّا رَعَيْنَهُ أَكْبَرْنَهُ وَقَطَعْنَا أَيْدِيَهُنَّ وَقُلْنَا حَاشَ لِلَّهِ مَا هَذَا بَشْرًا إِنْ هَذَا إِلَّا مَلَكٌ كَرِيمٌ. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, so when he came out to them, then they saw him. They exalted him at his beauty and in their astonishment cut their hands. And they said, how perfect is Allah, for Allah, or Allah forbid. No man is this. This is none other than a noble angel. So when they saw his beauty, they saw him that this can't be a man, this is an angel. So they also, when they saw him, they felt what the wife of the minister felt. They saw him and he was fair seeming to them. So they said the same things and they cut their own hands. Why did this woman, the minister of the Aziz, do this? Because she wanted to say to them, you blame me, but you haven't seen him. And this is why Islam says to the believing women, to the believing men, to lower their gazes. To lower their gazes so that they will not be affected by this illness and this sickness. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us concerning these women that when they saw this, they marveled at his beauty and they said, this is not a man, but this is an angel. And not just any angel, but an exalted, noble angel. Subhanallah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in this ayah, قَالَتْ فَذَلِكُنَّ الَّذِي لُمْتُنَّنِي فِيهِ. this woman now, the minister, the wife of the minister, she said, this is the same person you were blaming me concerning. You blame because of this young man. And that I had وَلَقَدْ رَاوَدْتُهُ عَنْ نَفْسِهِ and that I caused the tried to seduce him. فَاسْتَعْسَمَ so he sought protection with Allah from me. And then she said, وَلَئِنْ لَمْ يَفْعَلْ مَا أَعْمَرُهُ لَا يُسْجَنَنَّ وَلَا يَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الصَّابِرِينَ and if he doesn't do what I order him to do, then he will be imprisoned. See, why this particular situation is one of the worst, because this woman, she is in charge. She is the one who has the sulta. And the woman is not able to hold back her shahwa. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about Yusuf alayhi salam. What does Yusuf say? قَالَ رَبِّ السِّجْنُ أَحَبُّ إِلَيَّ مِمَّا يَدْخُونَ إِلَيْهِ He says, O Allah, the prison is more beloved to me than that which they call me to. And look at his statement. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِلَّا تَسْرِفُ عَنِّي كَيْدَهُنْ Except if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala turn away from me, they're plotting. And the word is كَيْدَهُنْ is plural. All of the women who saw Yusuf, from those women, from including the wife of the minister, and including those women who invited the black to this banquet, they all were seduced, trying to seduce Yusuf. And they were all inclined towards him. Brothers and sisters, this is one example from the examples of al-khalwa, which is forbidden. But there are many others. One such other example is that if we look in our homes, and this is one of the other very, very dangerous situations, is when there is free mixing between people who come into the home. Who, there shouldn't be free mixing. And there shouldn't be khalwa, where they're alone. And that is when relatives come to the home. And they come and they sit with maybe their cousins. And there is khalwa. This is something which is also forbidden. Many of the Muslims, when you hear this, they say, what is this? We never heard of this before. Yes, this is what Islam has enjoined upon us. Anybody that can be married together, there can be possibly khalwa. So if cousins sit together, then the women should be covered. And it shouldn't be khalwa, it should be in a majlis where there are other people. And in that also there should be some other guidelines. It's not allowed for a woman. This is unfortunately one of the problems today. There are many of the sisters who are coming now to the religion. And you see them, they cover their heads. And they cover their bodies, but they wear makeup and put perfume on and then go out in the street. What hijab is this? We beautify ourselves and we go outside. What are we calling to? Is this Islam we are calling to? Wallahi, this is not Islam. And this is also a fault. But why I mention this now? Because it happened in the home. And so this is part of the tarbiyah that mothers should give their daughters. And part of the tarbiyah of homes, which will help each other to preserve homes. If I had time, I would give you an example, a shocking example. But since time has already left us, this example inshallah I will give you next week. Then you will not scratch your head and say, why is the Imam telling us about this strange thing? We never heard of this before with our fathers. You will know it inshallah, and you will see how it can be very dangerous for people if they are allowed to make khalwa in this way. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us a people who may the truth, recognize the truth, give us the ability to accept, and also make us a people when we hear the fault, and recognize the fault, and give us the ability to avoid it. بسم فإن الله سبحانه وتعالى قد أمركم بذلك في كتابه فقال إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما وقال صلى الله عليه وسلم من صلى علي مرة واحدة صلى الله عليه بها عشرة اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد وارض اللهم أربعة الخلفاء الراشدين المهديين أبي بكر وعمر وعثمان وعلي وعن سائر أصحاب نبيك أجمعين ونهل بيت الطيبين الطاهرين وارض اللهم عنا ما هم بمنك وكرمك وجودك يا أرحم الراحمين
آمين
اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين وأذل الشرك والمشركين ودمر أعداء الدين واحمي حوزة الإسلام يا رب العالمين اللهم اغفر للمؤمنين والمؤمنات الأحياء منهم الأموات عباد الله رحمكم الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون اذكروا الله للذين يذكركم وادعوه يستجب لكم ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون وأقيم